Japanese are probably over here, you can stop.
But then, when war, Korean War, and of course, Chinese Civil War, all these. And even after the Vietnam War, some sort of unhappy sort of events here and there, including Iraq War. So, according to some history, immense violence during the 20th century, number of people who killed through violence, around 200 million. And also, I think, various methods, including nuclear weapon, use nuclear weapon. So, immense violence. Real sort of thing, great number of people killed and suffered. But there, sort of immense violence really create new shape, better shape of the world. That maybe or that violence is worthwhile, but that's not the case. Only suffering, more hatred, so that way more divisions. So therefore, now time comes. We have to think new way. It is not not right to take for granted way. Oh, world goes this way. I think it is no longer that way. I think we must think according to new reality. We must find out this different way of approach. And then on top of that, global warming. Meantime, population also increasing. And also the gap, rich and poor. How serious in Thailand? Rich and poor gap in Thailand? How much? Big? No? I think 2 years ago I was in Latin America, Mexico, Argentina, Brazil. So every sort of my talk, I ask audience, the rich and poor, how big? Every occasion day. Then, another question, corruption, how serious? Small? Again, big. I think recently, which country? I think recently, now I can't remember the name. Rich and poor, big. But corruption, very little. So now this also is a very serious matter. Now India, I often see telling my Indian friend, the Indian people, generally speaking, very rich-minded. But then, the corruption, quite serious. The reason, I think 3 years, in Jodhpur, while after I talk some students, then among the questions from student, one student asked me, the corruption is something normal. Therefore, the young student, you see, what question to me, he still study. So after he study, when he lives or life start, unless he involve corruption, he cannot possibly carry his normal life. Then after a few weeks, after a few days, I met one businessman in Bombay. He also mentioned, unless you involve corruption, your business will not be success. So then I really shocked. If people, every people, concerned people feel the corruption is the only way, then I think whether the Maya civilization, according to their sort of a prediction, now consider 2012, now world almost now come to end. So we will not survive. So not much reason to discuss. We just better to wait death. But whether you see that British too or not, this corruption, unless we really pay seriously and make clear public, this is wrong. Otherwise you see this corruption. I think usually I discuss the new worldwide disease of cancer. So now all this, including Buddhism, religions, last 1,000 years, still is very much involved among humanity. But frankly speaking, failed to check these things. Then democratic system and free press and rule of law, these also just supposed to sit in our method to check these things. But now India, really democratic country, wonderful, very stable, and rule of law. But then sometimes law itself is corrupted. So therefore, all these are the method or system which supposed to create just society, where just society, these things fail. So now, on the other hand, too much sort of centralized power, look China, full of corruption. So now, obviously, self-discipline is the key factor. How develop self-discipline? Moral principle. Moral principle not based on, say, Buddha or God. If I carry moral principle in my daily life, Buddha will get blessing. We will give me rest. We will get blessing. Or Jesus Christ, or Muhammad, Allah. So that also not adequate. So therefore, we need, this morning I briefly mentioned, secular ethics for one's own interest, out of awareness, if I remain truthful. I, personally, I will be more happier. And to that way, my physical health also better. And my own sort of community also feel better. So through awareness, the value of these moral principles. And through that way, self-discipline. Now how to teach that? Not relying on religion, but to use our common sense and scientific findings and common experience. So that's the that's the way of approach moral principle to secular education. So now here, I usually be telling the people whose age below 15 or below 20. How many people whose age below 20? Raise hand. Almost done. Actually, one. Then below 30, press more. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So then, perhaps I may ask the people whose age above 50. No, firstly, above, say, 70. First, 70. First, I myself. 70, 77. So you also. Now above 60. Now above 50. Okay. So, I believe my generation and also your generation, whose age already 50, our generation belongs to 20th century. Now that century gone. Now, logically, we ready to say bye-bye. Now the younger generation, below 30, you belong to the 21st century. So this century is your century. Now this century, 21st century, only 12 years now passed. The remaining yet to come. So future, is in our hand. Past is past. Nobody can control. Now future yet to come. So if the generation, mainly the generation, 21st century generation, you should think what kind of world you want. Peaceful? How can develop peaceful? World peace must come through inner peace. Without inner peace, impossible to achieve peaceful society, peaceful community, a peaceful world. Therefore, through education, we must educate people. The peace of mind, inner peace, is the ultimate important source of one's own successful life or day by day sort of happy mind, happy mood. We can teach through normal education field. So education is universal. Religion, no matter what important, what marvelous religion, will never be universal. So problem is facing humanity. So this method to solve that also must be worldwide, right? Through worldwide. So must be universally. So that's my view. So actually, some of our friends, you see, we are working now how to introduce moral ethics in modern education system. We already working. Now just so hard. Don't do this so hard. Don't try it. Don't do that. Because that the education, secular education, called that Kudusha Kudure. Ka. Just 2 meters juicy. February 14. Ka. Oh yes yes. January. Kasa. 14. So we are going to have some meeting, some scholars, even some scientists will participate. So we are, see, actually working something. So you Thai, we are part of humanity. This is our common responsibility, common interest. So have to think more seriously. But that's not our solution to world's problem. That's all. Lots of questions. If you have some new ideas to solve these problems through non-violent way, it's our common responsibility. We really need sense of global responsibility based on awareness, oneness of humanity. Difference of religion, difference of race, different of culture, different of language, these are secondary. Or nationality, secondary. Important is we all same human being. When Buddha taught Buddha Dharma, he never sort of meant his religion, but meant for particularly this sort of community or that sort of community. Never humanity. We Buddhists also is when we pray. Even we never say it's a happiness for human being. We never say that. Entire self being. And so now time comes, we must act on that. So Thai Buddhist, I'm Tibetan Buddhist. I'm always thinking about humanity. Now my brother, Buddhist brother, Thai monk, also should think entire 7 billion human being, not just Thai, or Bangkok. So that's that I want to tell you. Lots of questions.
Maybe ask former delegates from Thai representative to be with His Holiness for the question and answer session, please. Venerable Paprasan Visalo and Dr. Krishnapong Karatikorn and Dr. Sek San Prasad Gun. Yasopon is absent for this dialogue program because of one of his senior is passed away and he has to be attend the funeral in Thailand. Sir.
Your Holiness, you mentioned the importance of having inner peace among the people. But there are at least two questions arise from this segment. First, how is it possible for people to have inner peace while the society around them encourage greed, selfishness, and competition? Especially among the rich, you know, they live their life in greedy environment. Greed is good, somebody said. And the second question is that for a lot of people, billions of people, they think that inner peace is a luxury because they don't have food to eat, they don't have house to live, and sometimes they live in. is very difficult for them to survive in the war zone. So in the peace for them is very luxurious. What is Your Holiness response to that question?
Yes. Now, the global economy crisis a few years ago, so when it happened, I really surprised the most economists, or most economists or most important people, they, I think including their dream, always think about the economy, dollar, like that. So, they, such expert, some mystic, causing global economic crisis. It is, looks impossible. So, out of my own curiosity, I asked some of my friend, businessman, quite rich, and also advisor of multinational companies. I asked some of these people, what's the cause? And they say, greed, too much greed, and speculation, without knowing properly, just greed. Therefore, also part of this causes is ignorance. So this global economic crisis ultimately is linked with our emotions, too much greed. And without knowing, out of greed creates some speculation. Like that. And then obviously, rich and poor, directly related with greed and lack of sense of responsibility to help people, look after those poorer section of people. We must make distinction. Desire, greed, I think different. Desire, something good. Desire, everybody equal. More or less genuine socialist of view. Wonderful. And we Buddhist, we actually developing desire to achieve nirvana, achieve Buddhahood. But sometimes you see there's misunderstanding. Buddhism, Buddha, Buddhist practice, desire must also eliminate. That's wrong. Desire with some other mental element become bad. Desire with right, with logical things, that's right. Desire to achieve salvation, nirvana, moksha. And similarly, desire to achieve happy life. Just happy life, where? Justice where? Life with justice where? Also right. A desire to achieve one's own happiness, exploit other, bully other, cheating other. That desire is negative. So desire itself is neutral. With other motivation, desire can be positive. With other motivation, desire can be very negative. So even anger, anger out of compassion, out of sense of concern, anger could be positive anger. Anger out of really sort of negative feeling towards other, then that's negative. So these emotions, as a, its own sort of system, every emotion interdependent. So due to other factor, particular case, one emotion is negative. But under different circumstances, different reality, different circumstances, the same sort of emotion can be positive, like that. So greed. Those people whom I ask, they are not religious people. These are truly economists. They say that like that. So that's your first question. The second question, Kasa, only again. So when we said inner peace is so important, that does not mean we don't need material development. No. So Buddha, I said, renounce Maharaja, that was Nijong Samarva. We renounced from Kasota, worldly life. But for our necessity, Tsoye Jichusun Sasri. Tsoye Jichusun.
The 13 necessity equipment or the robes and so forth, monastics.
So like you see this upper sort of say dress and lower sort of garment, these things we monk should keep only one. And the extra there you must think that common with abbot or somewhere else. You cannot keep these things, extra things, or this is just mine. Only one. Each one. But meantime, if that one, because of that, Jivanaskar, offer someone else, mistake. So, that means we must keep this for our survival. So, monk's life, very simplicity, very much sort of emphasis, simple life, but at the same time, it clearly mentioned for survival, basic necessity must be key. So similarly, here, material development must develop, highly necessary. Little sort of reservation is some nation, some individual, very, very expensive, luxurious life. That, I think, perhaps because of that, according to the moral principle, so many people there, few individual, luxurious life, as immoral. If every people, 7 million people, they are sort of economic condition, highly sort of, reach the same, then maybe some little bit more luxuries, okay. But under present circumstances, too much luxuries of life, way of life is, I think, not good. Except that we need further material development, that we need. So there's no contradiction. Emphasis, development of inner peace, correct. Just on one part of the Muslim, one part of the Then you also question the needy people. Firstly, people under poverty, then while too much sort of hungry, we cannot say practice of compassion. You cannot say. I think it is all people, their life really difficult. And we Buddhists say, oh, due to your karma, nothing can be done. Wrong. After all, karma is one from action. Karma not come from Buddha or not come from sky. Karma means action. So, there are sort of unacceptable sort of condition It must change. So, first priority, actually, doona bashir kasa, doona bashir kasri. Ka?
The four ways of gathering disciples.
Tangujibutwa.
Yes. Now, the first one is giving alms.
Logically, person who first, you see, I mean who face the difficulties about their life, the first their main concern is the prasad, the material values. So offer material things. Then, nevermore.
Then talking with a sweet voice.
Then talking about right path. Then let them follow that. Meantime, we ourselves also implement these things. So four kasa.
The four ways of gathering disciples.
So like that. So first priority is physical, remove physical difficulties. Then next asade, deeper thing. However, see, we must make clear today, I think most of the 7 billion human beings never think, never realize ultimate source of happiness is within ourselves. Never. They simply feel money, power is the ultimate source of happiness. So Western lifestyle, now Thailand also now becoming like that, more and more westernized or material field, isn't it? Yeah. So you see the more materialistic way of life. So modern education also is a more materialistic oriented education. It's quite understandable. I think 1,000 years ago, when first time separate education institutions started. At that time, 1,000 years ago, at that time, the newly established education institution, now only responsibility is taking care about knowledge. About moral principles is concerned, church take care. Now time passes, the effect of church decline. And family value also decline. So then the newly developed education institution alone have the responsibility of both moral, because of that, educate moral responsibility, right? And education about brain. So now that now become very clear. I have, so several occasions, one example, one big university in America, the chancellor of that university, huge university, so very famous university. So a chancellor of such famous, sort of important university, they say, and when we met, so gradually he sort of expressed to me his deep insight, much worry, loneliness, and he often used to prefer remain isolated. Then we discussed, talk. Then, after some time, after our meeting, see, his that kind of way of thinking much changed. So that person become much happier. So his, now this is example, a chancellor, very educated, and good name, and then his income also, because of the very high university chancellor, his income also very good. So everybody respects him. But these facilities fail to bring inner happiness, inner peace. So that is important. We are not saying material development is not important. It's very important. Still we need more it is dormant, but more economy growth. But what we are seeing is material value is not the ultimate source of happiness or world peace.
Your Holiness, I think cultivating peace must come from inner peace. And I think that's absolutely true. But as you know, in each society and even in the whole world, there are structures oppressing people. And actually, there are structural conditions provoking violences from different sections of society. Do you think, apart from advocating the right view or spreading Buddhist teachings among the populace, do you think we should also struggle for social reforms or get involved in some forms of anti-injustice movements? I really need a spiritual explanation for this.
그래서 남수에게 가네. 그래서 바로 수술. 그저 수술. 근데 눈도 됐어, 눈도 됐어, 눈도 됐어.
Did they say anything wrong?
그래서 자. 어? 남수를 핑계줬어, 말 봐. 어? 뭐로? That's why we need some kind of secular education, some kind of education about moral ethics in existing modern education field. It can be worldwide. So that I think we can do. And people, I think nowadays there are some people who believe more to scientists rather than Buddha. Buddha 2,600 years ago. At that time, you see, no modern equipment. So some people used to feel like that. So therefore, I feel the scientific sort of research, they really like Buddhist analytical meditation. They really analyze, research. So they are finding, I think common people, I think, have to accept much easier. So therefore, as I mentioned earlier, on the basis of common sense, basis of common experience, basis of scientific finding, we can teach people the ultimate source of inner peace is within ourselves, more compassionate mind. Compassionate mind brings inner peace. Not talking about next life or not talking about heaven, simply a biological factor, on the basis of biological factor, more compassionate mind, more peaceful mind, calm mind is very essential.
Can we take political actions with compassion?
So therefore, firstly, I think worldwide education, in education, we must try to find lesson about moral ethics. Then along that, various sort of, sometimes say, NGO, more effective rather than government. So on particular field. In Khasa Tegi, Andy Khasa. Andy. Oh. Oh. So then these, of course, we really need, as I mentioned this morning, our common sort of responsibility. So the people from various sort of background, you see, we have to do something. So like that, and then, political. Now, it is unrealistic, uncompassionate politicians. Some compassionate politics come from an uncompassionate sort of politician, I think it's difficult. So we can't blame politicians. Politicians also come from our society. A society where not talking about these values, only money. Then politicians or administrators or businessmen or anyone come from that kind of society. Then they take the concept importance of money. It's become their part of their life. Now that we must take. That was it. Next question.
Do you have a question to ask His Holiness?
Your Holiness, is to follow from what you have just said about inner peace. You mentioned on many occasions that one should seek internal peace rather than the external peace. Peace cannot be achieved through declarations or something like that. Peace must be achieved internally. And you said that internal peace can be achieved without materials. It's about being honest, being truthful, being compassionate, and nonviolent. So Buddhism emphasizes internal development opposed to external changes like social actions or political actions that Dr. Seksan just mentioned. This being so, Buddhists in Thailand at least are criticized as being conservative forces. We are regarded as forces of conservatism. So we'd like to ask Your Holiness, what would be the right view regarding this criticism? That's the first question. The second question is that
then okay, I think let me answer the first question. As I mentioned this morning, sometimes you see, we religious people, not only Buddhists, but also Christians and Islams and some others, you see, we simply carry. Some rituals, some religious ceremony, we consider these are the important sort of part of religion. So then these, I think actually some kind of prayer meeting for success, violence. Okay, sometimes it happens. Now you see, during war, you see, both sides pray to God to win their war. I think God may confuse where his sort of blessing should go. So we, and many Buddhists, offering ritual meant for their long life, healthy body, successful business. Actually, it's not religious, not Dharma act. Dharma Act must think about its long-term benefit and ultimately for nirvana. Then every, with that kind of motivation, then every action becomes dharma. But you see, motivation just meant for this life. And that also say my family, my friend, exclusively. Then rituals, prayers, some offering, all essentially not Buddha Dharma. But many people simply you see, carry these rituals are more important. Then, like Four Noble, idea of Four Noble Truth. Four Noble Truth, really think about Four Noble Truth. That idea, that teaching can change our way of life, our way of view of man. And through that way, way of life can change. That is the practice of Dharma, not ritual or ceremony, these things. So, ordinary Tibetans also, you see, and many Chinese, they want ritual way, ritual way more, ceremonial way, like that. Like that. That's the connection. As I mentioned this morning, when I had a meeting, my first visit, I had a meeting with Shankara Pandamaraja. I just raised the question, as I mentioned earlier this morning. So I think we Buddhists, the Buddhist monk, particularly the Buddhist monk, or I think here I want to share. I always tell the Tibetan, I think accept Vinaya, Abhidhamma, and also this kasa sodan kasa dadiva marwa ti dua ka do sutra dadi ten ka sutra tripitaka and abhidhamma, these two I think teachings should make available to every people, not only monk, but also the lay people. Vinaya, of course, only those because ordained people. Otherwise, no other. It's simply it's a subject of knowledge. So then, through that way, teachers in various schools, more sort of knowledge about Buddha Dharma. Can teach student. Some time back, I met some Thai student who studied in Chandigarh, came to see me, and their complaint was, in Thailand, Christians, they come to the school or society and teach Christianity. Buddhist monk, unless you go to monastery, no possibility to get information. That's their complaint. So you see, we, now time come, we must sort of propagate, we must tell or educate Buddha Dharma in school. That's I think very, very important. In order to explain Buddha Dharma, teacher himself or herself, you see, should have more knowledge about Buddha Dharma. So they have to study more. It's one thing. Then monk, also, you see, I found in Japan some Buddhist temple. They create schools or colleges. So since they have some special relation with their monastery, so these Because children in school, school children, they also usually recite some, or say, a sutra like that. So I think that we should kasuda. We should make more effort to deal kasuda, which is there. In Vinaya Sutra, at that time, it's in no separate school, so not much mentioned about is a monk should participate in education field more actively. Not mentioned that. So I think the Buddha Dharma, very, very realistic approach. Actually, see, he expressed all my student, all my follower, bhikshus, scholars, should not accept my teaching out of faith, but rather through investigate and experiment. So that means he advised his follower should be realistic. In order to carry our life more realistic, we should know the reality. So in order to know the reality, you see, we must investigate. It is not sufficient, or this is our sort of traditional way. It must be that. No. So I think true Buddhist trained, I think there's no point to remain kasota. Conservative, which means something, way of thinking, something behind behind the time. So, like that. Now, next part of your question.
The second question, Your Holiness, in cultivating this inner peace, sometimes we arrive at situations that we have to strike a balance between equanimity or upekkha and compassion or metta, on the other hand, or detachment and involvement. What would be your holiness ideas on this? To strike a balance between upekkha and metta, compassion and equanimity, or detachment and involvement.
Kosa. Karuna or compassion. The ninjaliya,
So within compassion, we have it's twofold. One is the what is called defiled or afflicted compassion, and the other is non-afflicted compassion.
Because the compassion or the sense of concern of others' well-being. Which very much based on my friend, my body, or my friend. That kind of compassion, even animals also have, to some extent, particularly social animals. The youngster's attitude towards their mother, more some kind of affection or compassion. The mother's side to their youngster also is some kind of sense of concern. That is biological factor. That is sense of compassion essentially mixed with attachment. So that kind of compassion is very much based on others' attitude. So therefore, that is the compassion with mixture of attachment cannot extend towards our enemy or neutral person. Particularly enemy, you can't. So that sort of compassion is usually I call biased compassion. Now, the compassion which we are seeing is all religion, I think not only Buddhism, but also the Christian and some others of religious tradition, when they use the word of compassion is compassion, unbiased compassion towards all, for Buddhist, all sentient beings, and some other people, at least to all human beings. So that kind of compassion is not based on others' attitude, but rather the being itself. So therefore, person who create trouble for you, as far as their actions are concerned, we consider them enemy. But still they are human beings, a certain being. They also deserve our sense of concern. So that kind of compassion is unbiased compassion. So now, in order to develop infinite, objective, unbiased compassion, the biased compassion must reduce. The way or method to reduce that one-sided compassion is the equanimity, and detach to someone to whom you feel very, very close, special closeness really. Some other more distance. Now that must change. So the one particular level, you must practice detachment. Then develop infinite love, compassion, without mixture of attachment.
Your Holiness, you mentioned a lot about the importance of secular ethics among people in general. My question is, what is the role or the place of the spiritual or religious ethics? Should the general people or the non-believer have access or have a better understanding about religious ethics or spiritual ethics or not? Should they learn? What about the teaching about sunyata or emptiness? Is it important? Is it useful for the non-believer to understand in order to live peacefully with themselves and with the other people?
Sunyata, emptiness, I think the two way of presentation that. One, the interdependency. I think that, from that aspect, I think very much relevant in secular field. One sort of source of problem is when we see things which something you want, and that looks something independence. And something negative, you feel absolute negative. So one of my American friend, on great sort of experience, mental scientist, no,
Chong
Dong.
Psychiatrist.
Was Aaron Beck somewhere?
Aaron Beck.
Have you heard Aaron Beck? Anyone? Europeans? Aaron Beck? Oh, okay. So once he told me, when I met him, his age already 84. So very experienced person. He says that when we develop anger, the object which we feel very angry, you see, that object appears negative, but actually 90% of that negativeness is your own mental project. So exactly, Master Nagarjuna and these great Buddhist masters mentioned that. When we develop negative, destructive emotion, negative emotion, the object appears something either very positive or very negative, both mental exaggeration, like that. So therefore, when we face some positive and negative things, we should develop the view interdependency. So judging or looking from that view, you can see some negative things, also there are some positive things. The positive things, also some negative things. And negative things case, even is our own behavior, right? Our own soul also there, because of that. Our own part also is there. So, once we develop more holistic view, then the intensity of negative feeling or positive feeling decrease. So therefore, the concept of interdependency, immense help to develop holistic view. So such things are relevant. Now some scientists, they very much fond the concept of interdependency, interconnectedness. So that really very, very helpful to understand reality like that. And shunyata, I don't know. The aspect of shunyata, although it's the same meaning, but shunyata sometimes creates more danger, creates more confusion. Shunyata means nothingness. So you are free. So that's dangerous. And you need a lot of explanation. So that's more complicated. I think it's better to not mention that.
Your Holiness, in relation to what you just said, it makes me remember that last year you said to the Thai audience that Nirvana cannot be reached by praying or chanting, but only through wisdom that one can reach Nirvana. And that wisdom is actually is to be free from conceptualization and to be free from dualistic point of view. I think this is very important, especially for the situation in Thailand today. People tend to think in terms of black and white, and you are forced to choose side all the time. And once I try to tell my friends or people I know, sometimes I talk to the public about going beyond dualism, many people will laugh at me and even get angry with me. So what do you think we should do, you know, to cultivate the right point of view, which is to take into consideration the totality of reality above, you know, black and white, right or wrong? It's not easy, at least I've tried.
The view absolute, some white, some negative. So these certainly due to lack of holistic view, that's very clear. Then how to develop holistic view, just as a few talks, not sufficient. To systematically, year by year, in education field, I think that's the only way to cultivate right view or cultivate a certain sort of view, a certain concept. Otherwise, you see, as I mentioned this morning, recently in South India, the Tibetan important monastic, historical monastic institution. And he got, I think, 20,000 monk students and scholars. I taught over 50 hours. I think after I finished my teaching, how much changed their way of life? Questionable. So we must, you see, we must sort of carry some systematic way, systematic. So I always feel education is the key factor. So from kindergarten up to university level, then there is sort of possibility to achieve happier society. Society who have more sort of wisdom, more ability to judge reality. So eliminate emotions. That also very, very difficult. So what we should do is try to more balanced emotion. That's what we can achieve. Otherwise, complete elimination of emotion, negative emotion. That's a nirvana. Difficult. Possible, but difficult. I think Buddhist monk or Buddhist practitioner on this planet, I think at least I think around they got a million, 300 million, 400, 500, 600. Perhaps I think 600 to 700 million of Buddhists on this planet. Among them, I think who actually achieved nirvana, I think maybe 10. About that. Others are difficult, isn't it? So, completely eliminate and also all negative emotion is not easy. Through rigorous training. Entire history, any bhikshunis, never happened. Never happened. Chai chai nyan nye wei kitaa muti kiamo mo dhul dhul maare. Ka. Ani, ato chumten dek mo yun di kiamo mo dhul di yongta maare. Ka. Ka. So I think everybody knows, regarding Bhikshuni, during Buddha's own time, for example, his own mother ordained, and Khasa, Ubali Khasa, Ubali Sajibwe, Ka, Mazo Che. Entre eso, ¿verdad? Chiyongra, ah. It was a few hundred of women ordained. Which century Buddhism reached Thailand?
13th century. 13th century.
13th?
Yeah.
but it's a Kotai period.
And Burma?
I mean, 30 Ming Buddhist era.
Maybe earlier.
It is generally, we say that it is from the Asokan period. Buddhism arrived in Thailand in Asokan period based on archaeological evidences. But the Thai history, as a present history, we count more or less around the Sukhothai period, which is about 800 years ago.
May I add more, sir? Next month we have another archaeological conference in Thailand about what is the earliest Buddhist evidence in Southeast Asia Peninsula. Now, there is the evidence by scholars all around the world that the archaeological evidence is around 1st century BC. There is some evidence from northwestern India on the peninsula of Southeast Asia already. But Buddhism may come through traders, Indian traders. And after that, Buddhism flourished in Southeast Asia. There is a very clear evidence that is about 4th century AD that the Buddhist is flourished in what we call Thawarawadi period. That's come from Nakharachun Gonta and some areas of northeastern India through Bengal, Bay of Bengal, sir. And also we do have some others come through Bangladesh, and even we have evidence of Vajrayan, a lot of Vajrayan in
Bangladesh. Yes, one time I met one Dutch. He found on Bansha, that's one sort of instrument. About Tantiana. So he found that in Thailand. He mentioned some name of a place, but I can't remember. So one time, same with Bansha, tradition also, you see, once Kasoda flourished in Thailand. So I don't know. And also Sri Lanka. Actually, Rimalaya Sisti, Sarang Shiksu's Chatawa. So one famous sort of mountain where Buddhist Tantiana is developed, that actually exists in Sri Lanka. You say that, I don't know. We need more research work. But then Buddhism first, they reached Burma or Thailand. Between Burma and Thailand, which is earlier?
Your Holiness, I think the Thai state is probably the latest comer on the peninsula in Southeast Asia. But the place itself was occupied by other powers before 13th century. So I think during the Mongol invasion, of Asia, then all the states declined. Then the Thai tribe had a chance to establish their own state. So when we say Buddhism come to Thailand, we probably inherit. We already had Buddhism before that, but not under the Thai state, somebody else's power.
Yes.
It must be much older. Mm-hmm. Than the history of Thailand itself. History of Buddhism in Southeast Asia is much older, I think.
Right. And Burma and Thailand?
No, even in Java, in Indonesia.
Indonesia, Java, yes.
Yes. And in Cambodia, in Burma. Everywhere except Bangkok. I mean, we are newer state, coming from the ruins of others.
I think 11th century. What do I choose to call a century? 11th century. Atisha Dipankara came to Tibet from Bengal, and his sort of the biography. Biography, you see, he once visited Java area, Java, Sumatra, and one very famous Buddhist master, Sri Mukhasuri. So, Diva Lingma Ve. Oh, Suvana Diva. Ah, Suvana Diva. See, the Atisha Divankara received teaching from that master. He actually, now modern times we call in Indonesia. So at that time, a lot of sort of Buddhist practitioners, Buddhist followers there. Like that. So before Buddhism reached the Southeast Asia countries, so what kind of religion there? We Tibetan, I think 7th century, 8th century, then Buddhism reached Tibet. So before that, we have on our the ancient, what usually some of the modern scholars say shamanism in Siberia, in Tibet also. So in Thailand, before Buddhism came, what kind of religion?
The animism.
What?
Yes, it's animism. It's same as a shamanism. So? And also some of the Brahmin. The Brahmin was sort of passing through Thailand to Cambodia and all the way to even to Vietnam at the time. So I guess that during that time, as some of the scholar has said, that the state of Burma, state of Thailand is not clearly defined. It's
right.
Not announced. But the land, those lands was always influenced by not only animistic elements, but of course, it's a Brahminism, but of course, with the Buddhism, very heavy evidence of the Buddhism has been in the society, but we can't really say that this is a Thai Buddhism or this is about Buddhism. One of the very simple ideas is that Dr. Vancha mentioned that if you look at the China up there, we have a Silk Road, but
Silk Road.
But I think the world forget that. What about all these southern people done their trade?
The truth is,
yes, of course.
On road, on land, Silk Road.
Yes.
Another through sea.
But also in the southern of the India and Southeast Asia.
Yes.
There should be another road, which
that's
I
right.
call it as a cotton road.
That's right. That's
Silk
right.
Road and a cotton road.
Kasa. Kanos. Cotton. Oh, right.
So that's through that cotton road, which is obvious in the Tipitaka, there is a road there, which they used to trade. And then through that, Buddhism has been heavily influenced, heavily present in this Southeast Asian peninsula, actually. But of course, it's Mahayana Buddhism was dominated. Sometime the Theravada is dominated. Later on, Theravada dominated all. But however, being the same Buddhism, Mahayana and even the Vajrayana has embedded within the Theravada. So if we are talking about the true Theravada, in the Thai sort of setting, you still find that the Vajrayana elements we are practicing still do that.
Yes, even in Pakistan or Afghanistan, this area, some Muslims actually you see carrying some Buddhist puja, Buddhist offering. Like that.
Your Holiness, may I add more? What the new evidence that is found in not only in Thailand but also in Myanmar and Malaysia is mean the Southeast Asia Peninsula. We just found a lot of inscription of Buddha Dhamma, mostly three Buddha Dhamma is recorded from around 4th century AD. That is Yetamma. Yetamma.
Oh, Yetamma, Hindu
Dhamma. Yes, a lot of Yetamma tablets there.
Kasa.
In mostly in Sanskrit. A lot of
I also heard this mantra actually describing four noble truths. So this is something common in Sarvastra Pali tradition as well as Sanskrit tradition, both. I heard.
And what is found is Sanskrit. And all around, not only in southern Thailand, but also in central plain of Thailand. And second thing, we even found the inscription of Patijasamupabada. Patijasamupabada.
Patijasamupabada.
And also Dhammacakkappavattana Sutra. These are several inscriptions from 4th century AD in all around that area.
But this one is actually the 12th link from Kasa, Maripur Kasa, and Ka, Abhidya, from Abhidya, Kashi. Kashi. 12th link. That we describe Patisambhad. 12 Patisambhad. Like that. Really interesting. Very, very interesting. Now we really need... and then one my question. In Thai tradition, also I think Burmese tradition, it's a monkhood. Few years remain as a monk, then retire. Even I think the Thai king, I think a few months remain in monastery, become monk. Isn't it? So, in Vinaya, when at the time of we receive the vow, see, we pledge rest of my life remain that. So if at the time we're receiving vow, if we set up time, then you will not get that vow. Well, what do your Padma Moksha say?
Any other
response? No. Jesus Swami Bhagavad said the Malam Chaitya, Jesus Swami Thashek, but King Marwa.
Holiness, just to answer the small question just now, in our Patimokkha and in our ordination ceremony, actually, there is no vow that we vow to stay as a bhikkhu for our whole life. In our tradition, it is always an option or a possibility to disrobe at any time.
Of course, the Buddha made clear, so long as you can keep these vows, then keep if you... do not read. If you really feel difficult, then you have right to Akasvada, give back. It mentioned. But at the time we ordained, there are clearly the 5 points.
At the time of receiving the ordination, you need to observe an understanding of the five definiteness, that out of which one is the definiteness of time.
So in terms, my death.
That in terms of time, if you take the vow by saying, I'm going to receive this ordination for the rest of my life, then you will receive the ordination. And if you don't do that, you don't receive the ordination. So whether...
So that the apart
from... upavas, vows, rest of ordinations are until you live.
Whole
life. So the point is whether you have sources.
For so you quoted the Buddha clearly mentioned you have right to give up. That also is mentioned in our Vinaya Sutra, it mentioned. But same time, at the beginning, when we receive vow, they clearly mentioned, at that moment, you should motivate, this vow will keep till my death. Otherwise, the proper vow will not come.
That particular point is not something that we have. But if I might just say, in our ordination, it is very common to say the words Sabba Dukkha Nisarana Nibbana Sajikarana Thaya, which means I ordain for the purpose of the realizing the freedom from suffering, which is Nibbana.
That's right.
So the idea is there in some sense that when you ordain, you are making a very high aspiration.
That's right. That's right. The guna bhavas lobe yedhe duwa dosa kota ga ngeba jiwa chunu yungu chati sung chati.
What you are saying is absolutely true, because in the very beginning of the text by Guna Parva, where he wrote this text on Vinaya, he says...
Which we are studying there.
He starts the text by saying that this is written keeping in mind the needs of those who have this wish to achieve nirvana liberation.
In Thailand, monkhood, being monkhood, has many functions. One function is the channel or the opportunity for education, so that one can be cultivated and return to the world with enough education in terms of morality and sometimes in terms of secular education. So, if a young man does not attain the monkhood, he is not capable enough to lead the family life, to take responsibility in their maturity. So, education in Thailand has been obtained to be monkhood for the male. So this is the function of Thai monkhood, which is different from other countries or even from the Buddha's life, Buddha's time. It is not only the opportunity to cultivate realization of Nibbana, but also a part of a main source of education before modern education, before the school in Thailand.
His Holiness, may I just an idea. I'd be interested about these five aspects that a candidate for ordination needs to fulfill in order to make his vow. What I can remember from our ordination ceremony is the questioning of the candidate, where there's a reminder, this is the time for truth. Ayante satya kalo, ayante putta kalo. Maybe there's some correspondence in the aspects that you mentioned.
Asa. Good. Now we'll have tea. Tea break. Not quite hot here, like Bangkok. Very hot. So up the Rinpoche and you come here and further discussion. It's very useful. And thank you. See you again tomorrow.